So welcome everyone, we'll start in just a moment. Welcome everybody, I'm delighted to welcome you this evening. We've got a sparse crowd with us in person, but we've also got some joining us online. So I'm delighted to welcome you to our General Assembly and our board elections. And I thought I'd wait just a moment for Ezra to get the music's going on a little longer than we expected. I can see him working hard to get it turned off. There we go. Okay. So I thought I'd visually tell you what we're going to do this evening. As you saw in the beginning, we've got a student part of the program in the beginning and at the end. So in the beginning, as you walked in, you will have seen one of our classes and their teacher, Bernie Rios, did some work with the, they actually started out that I think this is important because it goes along with our mission, inspiring critical thinkers, lifelong learners, and responsible world citizens. They actually looked out at trying to find a problem that they noticed a problem in our community that they wanted to address related to the Venezuelan migrants that we often see driving around in the area. But I really applaud them because they didn't jump in to try to put their ideas onto this. Onto this issue and just go headfirst into doing what they thought would be best. Rather, they were really critical of the process and said, well, we don't know what their needs are. And so really what you see out there is just the first step in the project in trying to find out who they are, what their stories are, what problems they have and what needs they have. And so I think it's an example of that critical thinking and being a responsible global citizen as well. So then we're gonna have a little welcome from our board president, and then tell you a little bit about the role of the board of directors and about the election. We'll talk just briefly about some of the things that happened this year. And then we'll move on into next year, which includes a discussion of next year's budget and some of the board plans for next year. And then, like I said, we're going to end with with really an amazing student act. I think anybody not here will regret missing it. This year's talent show winner, and it's really an incredible act. Anticipating that. So at this point, I'd like to turn it over to Katie.
Oh. My name is Katie Buss. I'm the president of the board. And I apologize I couldn't be there this evening. I'm traveling for work, but I'd like to take a quick moment.
Just one moment.
To show some sentiments of appreciation. First,
I'm going to go back to Katie, but I need to get her sound plugged in. So Katie is our board president, and she unfortunately is leaving us. But she's done an incredible job of pulling the board together. We were a very new board this year, and Katie did a fabulous job of building excitement and enthusiasm for the board work. And so here she is.
Take a quick moment.
I'm going to try one more.
My name is Katie Buss. I'm the president of the board. And I apologize I couldn't be there this evening. I'm traveling for work, but I'd like to take a quick moment to show some sentiment.
I'm going to reset it one more time.
My name is Katie Buss. I'm the president of the board. And I apologize I couldn't be there this evening. I'm traveling for work, but I'd like to take a quick moment to show some sentiments of appreciation. First, to Dr. Krause and your administrative team. You guys do a lot behind the scenes that many people aren't aware of, and you're making our school better for each and every day. And down the road, we're going to see the effects of what you guys are doing. So thank you so much for all your hard work. To the faculty, the same. The teachers, you're amazing. You've transitioned from virtual to hybrid to presencial. Thank you for all your work. We really appreciate you. And finally, the heart and soul of ACS is you, the family. So parents out there, thank you for all the support you've been giving to your kids and helping them at home. And it's been rough with virtual, kind of getting back into it, but you guys have been there and supporting your kids and the kids as well. They're amazing. We're so excited to see their smiling faces at the school every day. So again, thank you all. I'm really proud and honored to be part of the ACS community. I love this school. I love the families and I love everyone working here. So honored to be a part of this group and thank you for coming this evening.
Thank you, Katie, who's watching from afar, I believe. There we go. At this point, I'd like to invite Maggie Frankie, our board vice president, as well as the chair of our governance committee and the chair of our elections committee, to tell us a little more about the role of the board, as well as describe the election process.
Hello, everyone. Again, my name is Maggie Frankie, and I did chair the nomination committee this past year, which was responsible for finding parents who would be willing and capable to serve on the board. Luckily at ACS, we have no shortage of talented and dedicated parents. And so many of you also may be wondering, like, what does the board do? I will tell you that the board can be very time consuming. It can be challenging, but I will tell you that it's been very important work for the school. The board, we do not focus on the day-to-day operations. And that can be a challenge because all of us on the board are also parents. But as a board member, our task is actually to develop and adopt sound fiscal policies, sound governance policies to ensure a sustainable future for ACS, while at the same time helping us meet our mission. But I would tell you tonight, if you spoke to any board member in this room, I think they will tell you that the work this past year has been very, very meaningful. For many reasons. I think the first is working on this board, it's all about our kids' education. So we get a chance to work on that. And then also working by side Andrew and Yanni and the principals and teachers and other parents, it's become really just really good work to work next to other people who are also committed to the school. So that leads me to thanking those people who are running for the board. Andrew, would you mind changing the slide? So we first want to thank you and then name those people. There is one position for Bolivians, and those people running for that position are Mario Guerra and Andrea Suazo. If you're here tonight, could you stand up and just wave? So thank you very much for running. For the third country national candidates, we have Lena Beltran and Jem Sarvan. I know Jem is traveling tonight. Lena, I don't know where he's in Santa Cruz. Okay. Yeah, so he could not be here tonight. Lena, I have not seen her yet, but she's also running. For the U.S. positions, we have Yvonne Gaviria and Joshua Darting. If you're here, Joshua's back there. And Yvonne's here. So the first, I want to say how grateful we are that you're running. We're very happy to see so many parents engaged. And I wanted to remind all the parents in this room and the parents who are listening that the elections do close tonight at 7 o'clock. And so if you have not yet voted, find your ballot in your email. If you cannot find your ballot in your email, you can use this QR code. Only those parents who are up to date with their tuition are eligible to vote. And our intent is that we will announce the winners before the end of this assembly tonight. And as part of that, I need to ask for 3 volunteers, people who are not running for the elections or related to them, to be part of our verification committee that reviews the election results before we bring them back in. Would there be 3 parents here tonight who could volunteer for that? We will meet in the back around 7:15 or so. I can't say it in Spanish very well, Maria. Would you be able to help me?
We've got one volunteer here.
One volunteer?
Están buscando voluntarios para ayudar a contar las votaciones a las 7:15. Necesitan 3 que no sean relacionados a la gente que está corriendo. Tenemos 2 ya. ¿Alguien más? ¿Uno más?
Is looking at the information that we get from the public notary, confirming that it looks accurate, signing it, and then then I will bring that back inside.
Entonces no es contar, es solo confirmar lo que el notario les va a dar y firmar. Perfecto, gracias.
Okay, thank you so much. Thank you for all the parents coming here tonight, those listening, all the parents who are running for the board. I hope more parents would like to run for the board in the future. Have a good night and thank you again.
Thank you, Maggie. I thought I'd just spend a few minutes reviewing a little bit of our year and what a year it has been. If you remember, on the 9th of August, we started virtually, and we were hoping and crossing our fingers and asking everybody we could and petitioning the ministry to try to let any student come back on campus. We didn't mind if we had two or three. We just wanted somebody back on campus. But luckily, with the help of the director distrital, we were able to start some biosecurity training on the 16th of August. And like a flower, that began to grow. We had a few more days of virtual, but then we went into hybrid. So by the 30th of August, we were into hybrid. And things went pretty smooth sailing for quite a while. And then to push the flower example a little, we got a cold frost that came along and slowed us up a little bit in the form of a COVID wave in early December. And so if you'll remember, we had to back up and go back virtual for a time. But luckily, that didn't last too long, and most of it occurred during the holiday. So by the time we got back, and we had another month, and then by January 31st, we went hybrid. And luckily, again, with the help from the director distrital, we were able to move into a fully presencial mode starting on February 7th. And let's all cross our fingers that we don't go back. So we've been happy to be able to, you know, slowly remove some of those biosecurity protocols. We're happy to have events like this evening with all of you here. And we're really looking forward to some other events at the end of the year, like our graduation ceremonies that'll take place outside, or the big one for 12th grade will take place outside, but we'll have parents, students, and some of their families all on campus together. So it's wonderful to be able to have that grow and grow over the course of the year. Another thing that happens that I wanted to mention, because oftentimes I think this is not a very visible part that you don't see as a parent. And it's that we really think of ourselves as a learning organization, not just for kids, but for everybody in the organization. It's so important. Education and work on the board, for that matter, isn't a simple task. It's not straightforward. There's no checklist or set of procedures that you go through and then you've done it right. It's constantly evolving, and because human beings, our students and ourselves, are complicated, and so it takes continual training to make sure that we're all doing the very best we can. And I think I want to just say how wonderful it is to be working with a board that modeled that from the very beginning. The very first training we had was a board training, and we'll do the same thing again next year. And then our academic committee even had an external consultant come in and work with them on how best to understand the work and to oversee the work that's going on in the school. Because if you imagine, it's quite complicated. You can't make anybody learn. You can set the conditions there. You can get them doing the right activities, but the students do the learning. But then the teachers have to set up the conditions so that the students are doing that work that most likely has them learn. The administration needs to set things up so that the teachers can do that work well, and the board needs to oversee all of that. And so it's a complicated set of tasks for everyone to do. And the academic committee sought some outside advice on making sure they were doing that to the best of their abilities. But we've had a lot of training going on inside the organization as well. At the we established an instructional leadership team, and that instructional leadership team has been spending a lot of time learning about instructional coaching. And the idea of that, you know, you think coaching and you think of sports and what goes on outside, but really the work that of teaching is very complex. And so if we can get peers and instructional leaders at all levels throughout the school going in and giving teachers feedback and helping them to improve on very specific parts of what they're doing each day, then we can see the progress for students ramp up throughout the school. And so, again, we've got that training in place. We'll continue that next year. We'll also start bringing in the teachers in so that they understand that as well. So when they work with those leaders, they're not surprised and they know how the process will work. Simultaneously, we've had an effort on literacy training that's been going on since almost at the beginning of the year, as well as mathematics, to improve both our literacy and mathematics all the way throughout elementary on up into middle. And we're doing some work in a slightly different way down from high school as well. And then we'll add to that some science training next year for our leadership and eventually roll that out in a similar way for the teachers as well. So this is one element that goes on in the background that you don't usually see, but is vitally important to moving our school ahead and making sure that students continue to learn at an optimal level, that we're able to take them wherever they are and have them grow to the very most that they can. Another thing on the other end of the school, after we do this training and we do the teaching and we do the and we go through the whole program, we hope that at the very end that kids are getting into the universities that they'd like to get into in the end. And I'll show you here, we do more than hope. It's a lot of hard work, particularly by our counseling staff. And so this bucolic scene, it's actually the springtime at one of the universities I went to. But unfortunately, you might have seen some headlines, particularly in the US, that calls this year's application process a horror show. Or some similar words. Some of them used even more colorful language. The idea was during the pandemic, really, that there was a lot of kids that deferred their admission to universities. And so they're all flooding back in trying to get in right now. And simultaneously, the universities stopped requiring tests like the SAT. And so the individual universities got a deluge of lots of applications that they didn't used to get because that criteria on the SAT, people said, well, you know, Harvard wants this number and mine's not anywhere near, so I won't apply. Well, this year, everybody said, it's my chance. I might as well apply. And so the problem is their admission staff stayed exactly the same. So they had this deluge of applications. Now, you might think under these conditions that we didn't do very well, but and this is an ongoing process, I'll say. The kids are continue to get in, but I just want to show you just some of the results. We had 21 students applying, but these are the acceptances that we have. Not one page, two page, three page, and the fourth page of acceptances to universities for these 21 students. And I just want to say a lot of that, that applause goes to our teachers for preparing them. And then also this year, Carolina Blanco, our counselor, who works tirelessly on getting these kids into these universities. But the best part you haven't seen yet. So we had 21 students applying, and those 21 students got offered $2,500,000 some US dollars worth of financial aid at these universities. When you divide that, now it did, you know, they didn't get it evenly, but when you divide that, that's more than 120,000 US dollars for each student. So I'm very pleased and thankful that our teachers prepare these students this well, and our guidance counselors are able to get them through the admissions process. One final thing that I'm going to mention is you know I think our academic staff is doing a wonderful job as I alluded to, but our non-academic staff is also doing a lot of great work. And when I arrived, and when Yanni, our business manager, arrived in the finance department, we really did not have very good financial reporting. The processes were going along, but it was very difficult for us to tell where we were at. And I'll tell you honestly, I was a little afraid, because it was kind of like I drove to Puerto Rico a few months ago, and it's kind of like you're driving out there and you just see the fog in front of you, and you're not quite sure whether when the fog clears, are you going to be over the cliff or are you going to be on the road? And the wonderful work of Yanni and our finance team has really made that fog clear. And thankfully, when it cleared, we were in good shape. and Yanni will tell you a lot more about it, but they reverse engineered essentially a budget for us for this year that we're now implementing. And he'll tell you a lot more about what's happening in the coming year as well. And so that brings me to a segue. I'd like to invite our treasurer and the chair of the finance committee, Martin Meneses, and I'd like to invite Yanni Romero, our business manager, up to tell us a little more about this year's finances, but more about next year's finances as well. Welcome, Martin. I can press the button for you guys if you can. Yeah, just tell me when.
Thank you very much, Andrew. We can go to the next slide. Well, welcome once again. And it comes the time in the presentation as the boring part, which is the numbers. But very important to keep the whole system in our school running. As Andrew mentioned, for several years, we have been reporting deficits and losses in our financial statement. So for this year, we worked on a budget that can get us through a break-even analysis, just to break the trend. It is important to mention that with the same budget, we had to include new softwares, platforms, licenses, biosecurity measures, biosecurity supplies, without adding one single dollar in our tuition. So it's just a redistribution of our costs, assigning in a more efficient way without compromising the education and quality of our services. In that sense, we can see that most of our budget, as in any other educational institution, goes to our salaries. Our salaries of our teachers, local international hires that we try to retain and attract to keep the results we have been showing for the last years in academic wise. And it's important also to mention and reflect when some parents come and say, oh, well, you know, we're in virtual modality and we need to reduce 30% of the tuition because the school is not using its infrastructure. It's not paying as much as a water bill or electricity bill. And I say, yes, that is true. But if you see those percentages of our utility services, for instance, it's 1.6% of our budget. So deducting any percent on our tuition really has a strong impact in our ability to keep ourselves financial stability. It's also interesting to see, as a board member mentioned, that 80%, which means 60% of our what we use in salaries and around 20% in financial and legal expenses, the school spends just to comply with our legal and financial regulations, or in other words, to keep us out of trouble. So our intent is to control on a monthly basis our budgets, present these financial reports to our board regarding the evolution of the expenses in our budgets, for us to react on a timely manner to any circumstance that the school presents. We are already taking into account into our budget, keeping the same biosecurity measures, not to release on any safety that the school has been taking, keeping the financial aid for the parents that have been struggling through these difficult times, even though that means a lot of commitment by our part in our budget. And also, of course, keeping all those scholarships that the ministry demands by law. This being said, our budget can withhold all this ambitious academic program that we have for the second year and the costs to keep this structure going. Nonetheless, we have two big problems that keep the school struggling to keep its head out of the surface. And for that purpose, I'm gonna present our treasurer, Martin Meneses, that will guide us through the next slides.
Well, good evening, mighty Cougars. My name is Martin Meneses. I'm the treasurer and chair of the finance committee. We have two big problems we need to solve. We need to solve them together. The first problem is the delinquent debt. Over the last 2 years, our delinquent debt has risen up to $600,000. Our new legal team and our management are working very hard in trying to collect. As you see, such an important number makes it very hard for us to make the necessary investments and improvements our school and our children need. The second problem we need to solve is late tuition payments. To give you an example, there are families who haven't paid tuition since September 2021. On a monthly basis, at least 15% of our parents pay tuition late, which means we're not receiving around $80,000 every month. The board has decided not to allow those families with outstanding debt to enroll next year. Come on, parents, we really need to get our act together. We need to work together. We need to make paying tuition on time a priority. I hope next assembly, we have the necessary resources to be talking of investments we can make in academics, teachers, athletics, getting a new playground, etc. I know we can make it, but we really need to work together. Thank you.
Just as a graphical exercise, so this was budget for this year, and if we just show the percentage of an impact that unpaid debt has on our budget, we can see how significant it is for us to keep ourselves running, at least meeting our costs with this cash flow problem, which is the unpaid debt. We need to comply with all our costs. Nonetheless, it's very difficult, and we need to get resources from other accounts just to keep up with our obligations that come from all our activities throughout the year. So as Martin says, I know everyone's struggling, but parents that have overdue debts all the way back to September, we really need to help the school pay all its expenses just for this school year. Thank you.
Thank you, Martin. Thank you, Yanni. At this point, we are nearing the time for the election. So the election closes. So I'd like to ask, we're not quite at the time yet, but at least maybe if you volunteered, if you can make your way toward the back of the auditorium at least, and then Maggie will direct everybody once we're ready to actually do the counting. But thank you to the three volunteers, and thank you to the election committee. We're excited to hear the results very soon. While the election committee is moving toward the back, I'd like to invite our secretary, who also serves as the member of the finance committee and a member of the governance committee, Ivan Gaviria, to tell us a little bit about both the board this year as well as the board in the future next year.
Thank you. Buenas noches. ¿Cómo estamos? ¿Todo bien? Mi nombre es Iván Gaviria. Soy el secretario del directorio. Qué pena que no tengo pues el traje con la corbata y todo. Inclusive saliendo de la casa, mi hija dijo, papi, yo sé que vas para el directorio. ¿Y cómo supiste, mi amor? Porque en la escuela, ¿cierto? Ponen las fechas de todas las reuniones y todo. Y le dije, ah, ok, qué bien. Y después me dice, ¿y te vas a ir así? Y le dije, no, gorda, es que yo me he visto así. Pero el punto es que, o sea, queremos proyectar una imagen muy descomplicada. Siendo parte del directorio no significa absolutamente nada fuera de que somos papás, somos padres todos. Yo tengo dos hijos que estudian acá en el Calvert y todos tenemos el mismo propósito, de que nuestros hijos y hijas, ¿cierto?, superan, de que aprenden, de que logran entrar en una de estas universidades que vi algunas, y estamos hablando de escuelas muy buenas. Entonces, ese es el propósito, ¿no? Pero, a ver, hablando un poquito de datos, y para compartir un poquito lo que hacemos, lo que hemos hecho en números concretos, 150 horas en reuniones del directorio, 80 horas en comités de gobernanza y apoyo financiero, 14 horas en comités para levantar plata y para el mantenimiento de la escuela, 22 horas en el comité académico, 21 horas en el comité de finanzas. Más de 287 horas en total que nosotros hemos trabajado para el bien tanto de la escuela como para nuestros hijos. Lo bueno de ser miembro del directorio es de que paga igual que ser papá, así que estamos todos muy, muy ricos, ¿no? Comento también de que tuvimos participación de 25 papás que asistieron el 31 de marzo, un evento del vino y el queso. Estábamos súper alegres de que atendieron tanta gente interesada en colaborar, en participar, en apoyar tanto a la escuela como a sus propios hijos y los hijos demás. Y 12 personas actualmente están colaborando en el comité para llevar a cabo una gala de fin de año, porque siendo parte de una comunidad, siendo parte de esta familia de Calvert, pues lo tenemos que celebrar y lo vamos a celebrar a fin de año en la gala. Bueno, voy a cambiar a inglés. Again, one of the important things we wanted to cover today is some of the big wins that we've had as a school and as a board. We were the first to open in La Paz, right? Fully presencial. We have worked tirelessly on creating greater financial stability and transparency. And I tip my hat to Yanni, who has been pivotal in making this happen, and as well as the leadership of Andrew and our principals, who honestly, you guys are the directors of the orchestra, and without whom I don't think anything would happen, right? We need to be organized and you guys make it happen. So thank you so much. Managing the complete transition of the administration. The majority of us, the board of directors, as well as the superintendent, business manager, we're all new. Todos somos nuevos. Entonces, manejar esa transición, ¿cierto? Y esa curva de aprendizaje ha sido bastante, ha sido un reto grande, pero lo hemos superado. Beginning initiatives that invited more parent involvement. At the end of the day, the reason that I'm here, that we're here, is for our children and to make sure that they are in a safe environment in a positive academic learning environment and that they grow and prosper not only as students, but as people. And one of the ways that we do that is by getting all of you involved, by taking what we are as the board and bringing it, you know, bringing it down to just the fact that we're parents, that we want to be with you. We want to spend time with you to understand what your needs are, what your concerns are, and to make sure that you understand that you are being heard. Te estamos escuchando. Por eso mantenemos o queremos mantener un nivel de cercanía con ustedes más constante y más a la medida de ustedes como papás. And then, can you hit the next slide, please? So now that we've talked about a little bit about what we're doing, let's talk about where we want to go. So obviously, we've already talked about all the training that we've been doing, the community outreach that we're doing now, the financial, the increase in the financial stability of the school, which has been essential to allow us to do what we need to do and to allow the teachers to do what they do. And then, of course, some of these other things that we talked about, understanding what our strategic mission is going to be, bringing our facilities back to par. We're opening up the pool again. We're looking at other facility-minded initiatives as well. But where do we go? What happens now? Now that all of us we're not new anymore, right? We can't complain that we're all new because we've been doing this now for enough time to know exactly where we need to go. The two most important things that we want to focus on as a board is ensuring that we meet all of your needs, that we are listening to you as parents and stakeholders of the school, and to ensure that you feel like you are also a part of this big family. And by that, I mean, we are accessible to you. Please don't feel like you can't come and talk to us. We're going to be doing more events to ensure that you feel heard and that you feel like the things that you need for your children, for the school, et cetera, are being registered, and so that we can begin to address them in a prioritized manner. And the second thing, of course, is continuing to ensure that our policies, our financial policies, our governance policies are all aligned with international best practice. ACS Calvert is a premier institution in the continent, and we will continue to be as long as we have sound financial policies, governance policies, and of course, with the support of the families and the students. So I'll end just by saying thank you very much to all of you, because without you, without your children, there is no school. So thank you so much for everything that you do to keep your kids here with us, and thank you for your trust. Thank you for your trust in us as a board to continue doing all the strategic management for your children and for the families. And thank you, Andrew, and thank you to the principals of the school and to the rest of the board. We could not do this without you.
Thank you, Yvonne. And thank you once again to both our board, current 2021-22, and our board in the future, the 2022-23 board. This has truly been an incredible group to work with, and I don't say that just because they're nice people. They can be challenging too. They keep us on our toes in the administration, but it's a good thing. We're working together, and we're pushing the school together, both from the board side and from the administration side. I want to pick up just a little bit on where Yvonne left off. And I'd like to do that by telling you about a study that happened actually a fair number of years ago at this point. But a researcher, Jim Collins, was looking at businesses, and you may have seen this work. But he looked at businesses that were all quite successful. They were good businesses by, you know, all kinds of metrics. They were in many of them were in the Fortune 500 list. They were by any measure good companies. And he watched them, or actually he went backwards. He and this team spent 10,000 hours combing through data and went backwards, and he found a group of them that made an incredible change. Even though they were good companies, and this is a financial metric on the on the axis going up this way. But even though they were good companies, some of them took this amazing change and really had a dramatic increase, whereas the rest of them stayed good. They weren't bad by any means, and the average still looked pretty good on this particular metric. But they really this subset made a dramatic change. And he looked at those. He and his team spent a long time looking at these at this group of companies and said, "Well, what made the difference? What made them?" And he coined this as being, you know, going from good to great. What made these companies go from good to great, and why did the rest of them just stay good? Now, his book talks a lot about that, I'm going to be sharing as we go forward more of that with some of our teams. But one thing that's different about a for-profit company like he was working with and a school like us — incidentally, he wrote another book about nonprofits like us — but one thing that's different is that it's really easy to measure this transition when you're looking at a for-profit company, because you can look at financial metrics and you can say, yeah, they really zoomed up here. But for a school, we're not looking to make money. That's not our goal. All of our money goes back into the school to help our programs. So what is it for ACS that would signify a transition from being a really good school to a great school? How could we make this kind of jump? And that's a question I'd love to ask you today. Whether you're at home or whether you're here, if you take this QR code and just scan it, and then just put in 40 characters or less, and you can put multiple submissions if you want, but what do you think it would look like if we made ACS great? So again, it's easy to do that from a for-profit company because you can see their financials go up. But what would it mean to you to make a dramatic transition and the difference between good and great? What would ACS look like if we all said it is great? And personally, I think it's a great school. But if we could make that big of a transition here, what might it look like? So I'll give you just a couple moments to type in some responses, and we can watch them come in once everybody gets the QR code. We're starting to get some of these come in, and you can certainly continue answering if you think of other things you'd like to put up there. We'll keep this open, but Looks like we've got increased Ivy League acceptance, rigorous athletics program, after-school programs in STEM, financial measurements, solvency financially, and ability to reinvest in kids, SAT scores above 1400, modern infrastructure, excellent writing, students as leaders. All students go to the college of their choice. I'm guessing that ran out of 40 characters. But thank you for those. And you can continue entering them either at home or here in person. At this point, we'd like to invite the board members down to the front here, just on the floor, and we'll take any questions that you might have either in the audience, or I don't know if Isra has the if we're able to, we'll take some from at home as well. Sounds good to me, as long as we're okay with, yeah.
Oh, sure. I mean, I think the question we do get a lot, and Yvonne's talked about it. Can we get this? Is I think a lot of parents do wonder how they give more feedback to the board. And I think that's one of our priorities for next year as the board looks at ways in which, and I think COVID has affected it all for a lot of us, but how do we work more in the community so that we are with teachers more, parents more, students more, so we get that chance to have more of a dialogue and conversation with parents. So I'll tell you that will be a priority of ours moving forward. Any sense that you feel like you're not being heard or like you have an idea to share, like Yvonne said, I hope you feel like this is a board and an administration that you can approach, because I think our school is the strongest when we feel like we have trust amongst each other, conversation amongst ourselves, and that we're all working in that same direction to make our school great. Other questions that, do you want to say that?
Well, I was going to say.
Me ahogo con esta cosa, me la tengo que quitar si no me... otra pregunta que con mucha frecuencia nos llega al directorio es ¿qué más puedo hacer? ¿Cómo me integro? ¿Cómo puedo apoyar? Y hay una, o sea, opciones sin fines, ¿cómo puedes ayudar no estando en el directorio? Porque también tenemos varios comités. Por ejemplo, nuestro colega Daniel está lidiando el tema de la gala. Por supuesto, esto no lo podemos hacer solitos. Necesitamos contar con tu apoyo y además con tus ideas, tus conocimientos, para hacer que el evento, cierto, luce y salga bien. Si tenés algunas otras ideas para colaborar en distintos temas, pues nos tienes que avisar. Y si de pronto no existe un comité particular, lo podemos crear. Pero necesitamos escuchar de ustedes, porque nosotros pues no tenemos todas las soluciones. Las ideas, las buenas ideas, muchas veces vienen de las familias. Tenemos una pregunta, no sé, atrás. Online question? Oh, okay. Bueno, en fin, eso era una pregunta que muchas veces nos llega, ¿cómo puedo involucrarme más? Y espero haber, cierto, respondido adecuadamente. No, I don't know if you guys want to add anything else.
at the photograph
outside. Sure. Do they need more time? Yeah, so it looks like we need a little bit more time for the voting process, the counting. So there's a beautiful exhibit outside. I don't know if you've seen it when you walked in, but the small group of students, the V team, I believe Andrew discussed this at the very beginning. And for those who haven't seen it, it's actually really cool because you can get your phone and you look on the QR code, and the QR code has an audio file linked to the image. And one of the images back there was really cool. It was of one of the gentlemen who performs in the street, and he's wearing all gold. And if you listen to the file, the gentleman says something really, really profound. And he says, you know, despite all the adversity that he is currently living, being away from home, not in his country, with all the political instability in his home country in Venezuela, he says, I do this because I feel that art can change the world. And I don't know, it just kind of, it made the hairs on my arm stand up, because I thought of not just the message that he's conveying about art changing the world, I started thinking about the kids who are going out in the street and presenting this information and presenting this connectivity. And I was like, you know, art is great, but these kids are going to change the world. So I just wanted to share that, but I do suggest you go back there and take a look. It's really, really cool.
So we'll just take a 5-minute intermission while the committee is working. And at the same time, I think we'll set up the stage for the final act at the end. So just 5 minutes, please feel free to take a look in the lobby or use the restroom, and we'll be back shortly. So if I could have everyone's attention once again, we will we have the voting is finished. And so if you're out in the lobby, please come back in. We'll have the announcement in just a moment.
Everyone's back inside? Seems like everyone's back inside. Okay, well, first of all, again, I just want to thank everyone who was willing to run for the board. And then announce the winners of the election who will be serving on our board for 2022 and 2023. For the Bolivian position, it'll be Andrea Suazu. For the third country positions, there are two. It'll be Lina Beltran and Jem Sarvan. Thank you again. And then for the Open American positions, it'll be Ivan Gaviria, who's with us this past year, and Josh Darting. So again, congratulations. Thank you to everyone. We really appreciate the interest. And as we go forward, we hope to create more and more interest in serving on the boards and finding other ways to participate. So thank you. I think Andrew has one last announcement.
So I'm very pleased at this point to welcome the final act of today. And I think it's meaningful both for the service of the board and the focus of the administration and the teachers and the entire school is on the students, on our kids. And you saw the wonderful work out in the lobby of our students that are working with the Venezuelan migrants. But now we have a very high energy program that I'm excited to introduce. I'm excited to introduce Suri Sanchez. She's a sixth grader who won the senior school talent show, the secondary school talent show. And that, to begin with, is an incredible feat. On top of it, I think that we have the solution for the General Assembly's not being packed full, because I think all of you will go away after seeing this act and tell everyone else, and they won't miss the one in the fall. So if you would, please give a round of applause and welcome to Suri Sanchez.
Out in the middle of a big dance floor, when I hear that fiddle, wanna beg for more. Wanna dance to a band from a Louisiana tonight. Yeah, but never have a wander down to New Orleans. Never have drifted down a bayou stream. But I heard that music on the radio, and I swore someday I was gonna go down a highway 10, past the Lafayette. There's a Baton Rouge and I won't forget to send you a card with my regrets, cause I'm never gonna come back home. Saturday night and the moon is out, I wanna head on over to the Twist and Shout. Find a two-step partner and a Cajun beat. When it lifts me up, I'm gonna find my feet. Out in the middle of a big dance floor, and I hear that fiddle, wanna beg for more. Wanna dance to a band from a Louisiana tonight. Hey! Alligator stew and a crawfish pie, a Gulf storm blowing into town tonight. Living on the Delta Quiet Show, they got hurricane parties every time it blows. But here I know it's a cold, cold rain, and there ain't no cure for my blues today, except when the paper says blow some days. I'm coming into town, baby, let's go down. It's Saturday night and the moon is out, I wanna head on over to the Twist and Shout. Find a two-step partner and a Cajun beat. When it lifts me up, I'm gonna find my feet. Out in the middle of a big dance floor, when I hear that fiddle, wanna beg for more. Wanna dance to a band from a Louisiana tonight. We'll be right back. Papa, bring your sister too. They got lots of music and lots of room. When they play you a waltz from the 1910, you're gonna feel a little bit young again. When you learn to dance with your rock and roll, you learn to swim with the do-say-do, but you learn to love at the fin-do-do when you hear a little show in the club. Saturday night and the moon is out, I wanna head on over to the twist and shout. Find a two-step bar to red occasion beat. When it lifts me up, I'm gonna find my feet. Out in the middle of a big dance floor, when I hear that fiddle, I wanna beg for more. Wanna dance to a band from a Louisiana tonight. Hey, yeah.